What up, everybody? This is Cindy with MoBoogie.net coming at you from downtown Denver's Fillmore Theater. This time I'm here with Xavier Rudd, who's got a show tonight. How are you doing?
Good, thanks. Thank you.
Excellent. Well, the first thing I have to talk to you about is your latest release, Dark Shades of Blue. Fabulous album, released here in the U.S. just last August. And I wanted to talk to you because in comparison to your other studio work, this album really has a different feel to it. It's a little edgier, a little darker in places. And I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit about some of the influences that went into creating such a unique sound.
I think, yeah, it's a little darker. I think there's always been light and dark in my music, but I think maybe we captured the dark a little better this time, you know? Which is something I've always tried to translate, is a thicker sound on CD. Like, you know, predominantly I've always been a live artist, and what I create live is quite a thick sound. And to replicate that on CD was always hard. And I never spent a lot of time in the studio, you know, I did things pretty quickly. Whereas on this album, the one before and this one in particular, we spent more time, we really concentrated on the setup. And we spent most of the time setting everything up and made it sound huge before we even started. I got some really good amps in the last couple of years, you know, when I was writing the music, and I'm always trying to expand my sound, you know. I've always done that, and I think, yeah, as a result, it sort of turned out thicker. I think we pulled it off, you know. I like the tone of it. I think it sounds great.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
Thank you.
Now, I know you've done a lot of your studio work in the past in Canada, but for this particular album, you decided to record it in Australia. What made you decide to do that, and how do you think that impacted the overall production?
It's just circumstance for me with recording. It's where we are at the time and what we're doing. And this time, we were coming home. And the last 2 years were probably the busiest touring years I had. And we were coming from the winter in North America, and I was ready to be home, you know. It had been a long time touring, lots of high highs, but there was some lows too, you know, and I needed to go home and just refuel. So when I recorded Dark Shades of Blue, I was in that mode of coming home and feeling, you know, like, I'm home, you know. And through the whole album, I slept outside by the fire with my dog and looking at Jodhpur or the Southern Cross, which is the what I looked at as a kid all the time growing up, you know. And so I had that energy, and then in the mornings, you know, I was surfing, I was on the beach, and I was home and doing all the things I grew up doing. And then we were recording in the afternoon. So I think I can hear that energy. That, you know, I was pumped when I was recording, and I can hear that in the album. And I can also hear tonally, I think, a lot of my wood, the woods, my instruments are made from Australian timbers, and I think the wood reacted better to the humidity. It was, there's a richer tone, you know, I think, from the acoustic quality of the wood, of the instruments too.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, those are the factors.
Wonderful. Now, taking all that into account, is that something that you would try and recapture and do again, or do you kind of just go with the flow and let circumstance guide you on stuff like that?
Yeah, I don't think about stuff much or plan it. It's just kind of like, and with my songwriting, I guess I don't ever sit down and try and write a song. They just come through me, and they come whenever they come, and then the ones that come strong enough to stay, they stay, because I don't write anything down. And the ones that aren't meant to stay, they go. And that's sort of how my songwriting process starts. So I go around and I keep it all in my head, and I know how it's going to go. And then eventually when I get full, I go and record. So it's wherever we are, and so we usually figure that out at the time. So, yeah, I'd like to do it again. I mean, that place was great. It was a great place to record. Byron Bay's a beautiful place, and the whole coast is very powerful. It's a very sacred area too, which kind of gels with me. So it's men's country, which was good. I couldn't do it if it was women's country. The spirits would drive me out of there. What are you doing here?
They might be kinder than that.
No, they drive me away. Go over the hill. Then come back when you're done.
We'll take the finish.
Yeah. But don't be bringing that emotion here.
Well, I wanted to talk to you about some of the individual tracks on the album, because there are some really incredibly powerful stories behind the tracks. First of all, I was wondering if you could talk a little bit. I know the first two tracks kind of flow into each other, the Blackwater and the Dark Shades of Blue. So I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit about what inspired those.
Well, Blackwater is the name of the painting. My wife's a painter, and the painting that's on the front cover is one of her paintings. And that's called Blackwater. That's the name of her painting. And that painting comes from a recurring dream she's had ever since she was a child, where she was in a horse and cart. It was very dark, kind of grey, and the horse and cart was going through the snow, and she was with a little boy, and she was peeling an orange for a little boy, and then the cart went off into the water, into black water, and then she'd see through the bubbles and the water, she'd see the orange peel floating up, and that was when she'd wake up, and she always had that. And so that's the story of that painting. And then for me, this whole album, it was interesting, because in the last 2 years that I wrote this album, the painting, she was painting a collection of stuff at the same time. So for me to come home and reflect on my wife's paintings all the time, and we're so connected, and for me to sit there and stare at our journey through her paintings was really powerful. And so it made sense to have those paintings as the cover art, you know. And so the song Dark Shades of Blue comes from that, from actually staring at that painting, but that's my opinion of it, my reflection, you know.
Okay.
So to merge those two made sense.
Now, how about Guku? I was wondering if you could tell me, without making me cry, the story
behind
that track.
It made me cry when we recorded it. Guku's pretty powerful. I guess it begins with Mo Wawa, who is a Yolngu man from northeast Arnhem Land, traditional Aboriginal fella, from a place where the British never settled, so it's still very strong. There's not much English up there, you know, it's all Yolngu language, and they've been able to maintain their culture and language and everything. He adopted me into his clan like 5 years ago, so, and we had a strong connection, and he's a descendant of Yidaki, the man who found the instrument that I play, or commonly known as didgeridoo, but mm-hmm. Yidaki you found it 60,000 years ago. Anyway, my Wawa, which means brother, I can't say his name for 8 years until after he's died, but he died, and I was actually on tour in the US last year when he died, and I was playing a song called Messages, which sort of comes from a space of that whole spiritual experience. And in the middle of the song, the day that I got word that he died, so he died like 24 hours maybe before that, I just started singing Guku. The whole thing, as you hear it on the CD, it just came out of me right in the middle of Messages. And it was pretty powerful. And that was him. That wasn't me. That was him coming through. He's very strong. And he's quite often around me these days, you know, when I play, and I can feel him and I acknowledge him. And So when I recorded that song in the album, I had his brother, Bunala Marika, come down from that place. And we talked about the song. He sang on a few songs, and we talked about Guku, and I said it's a dedication to Wawa, you know, and I told him the story of that day and how that song came through me. And he just nodded and said, okay, and he went in there and he sang traditional Guku. The song that you hear in the middle of the song is actually the song called Guku, and that is the Aboriginal song that's been sung since the beginning of time. Thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of years. And that was my Wawa's totem, his brother's totem. And Guku means honey ant. It's an ant in the north of Australia. You can eat the abdomen. It's like honey. Mm. So he sang that in the middle of the song, went in there one take and just sang that up. And he sang it to his brother with tears in his eyes. And everyone in the studio was just floored, you know. So it was the most powerful emotional experience for me. And you know, it was one of those times where I just was, you know, buckled me at the knees, you know, just reflecting on my journey and all the connections that I've made and you know, the gift of that I have.